So now that I've got this on the bench, I want to do some of the basic service adjustments and cleaning of the front face. I've re-veneered, repainted, finished the wooden case and grill. I don't think I've done anything except just a light dusting with a brush to the front face. So I'm going to remove the wooden case, remove the front dial face. And of course, in order to do that, I need to remove all the knobs, clean all those knobs, clean the front, and do the adjustments inside. So for the Marantz, there was a DC offset adjustment and a bias current adjustment. There is no bias current adjustment in this Pioneer, probably because it uses those SDK modules in the power amplifier. But there is a DC offset adjustment. Of course, there's tuner adjustments. I'm not going to do any of those, at least not now. So DC balance. Oh, and the meter drive circuit can be adjusted. So it tells me to put in a 1 kHz signal, adjust the level of the input signal so that the voltage on the output terminals for the speakers is 20 volts RMS, and then to adjust variable resistors for the left and right channels so that the power meters read exactly 50 watts. So I can do that adjustment. And that's worth doing. Instructions for the DC balance or offset, that it turn the variable resistor all the way counterclockwise and then bring it back to zero. Turning it all the way counterclockwise is useful to demonstrate the full range. That's about a diode drop, 646 millivolts. So I want to use the variable resistor to compensate for that diode drop, get it to zero. The sensitivity of the variable resistors is such that getting it within plus or minus 10 millivolts is probably sufficient, though I'd like to get it within plus or minus 5 if I can. All right, that's the right channel. I'd already done the left channel. Wanted to give things a chance to warm up and stabilize before I did the final proofing, but that is pretty good. That's within plus or minus a millivolt. So I'm going to go back to the other channel where we've got a little over 5 millivolts. That might be satisfactory, but again, let's see if I can get it a little bit closer. Hey!
Hey!
What's that?
I'm about to leave and go see Cypress Hill.
Oh, good. You're getting your nap in?
Yeah.
Yeah, you're kind of sleepy when I woke you. Sorry about that. Didn't figure you'd be in such a sound sleep in the middle of the day.
Me neither.
Anyway, drive carefully, be safe, and have lots of fun.
Grab an energy drink before I go.
We'll have fun.
Thank you.
Love you.
Love you.
So it's drifting around a bit, but that is pretty spot on. I'd rather it weren't drifting back and forth, but if it's drifting back and forth, it seems to be doing it about zero. So that's the so-called DC balance of the power amplifier, and then the next is for the meter drive circuit. To reprise the instructions for the DC balance, say, turn VR5 for the left channel and VR6 for the right channel fully around in the counterclockwise direction. Without any load and input signal, turn the power switch on. Connect a DC voltmeter between terminals 9, number 6 for right channel and ground. Adjust VR5, VR6 for right channel for 0 volts reading on a DC voltmeter. This level cannot be attained. Disconnect the jumper lead A or reconnect if already disconnected and then readjust. Disconnect jumper lead B for right channel. And there are jumper leads in there. Those would need to be desoldered from the bottom. For the meter drive circuit, I am to connect an AC voltmeter to the speaker's A terminals, set the function switch to aux position and speaker's A to switch to on, and apply a 1 kilohertz signal to the aux terminals, adjust the level of this input signal so that the voltage on the output terminals, speaker's A, read 20 volts RMS, and then adjust VR7 for the left channel and VR8 for the right channel so that the power meters read 50 watts. And it has a diagram to indicate which is which variable resistor, which is good because they're not labeled on the top of the PC board. Now, I'm assuming I can adjust the level of the input signal both with the source, which I'm going to use the function generator app on my phone, or the volume on the preamp, so long as I get it to 20 volts RMS at the output. I did the adjustment for the meters. Apparently I did it off camera. Either I forgot to hit record or my camera was full and refused to record. So here's what I found. I was able to get the meters set, and that wasn't hard. I jiggled the left channel one just a tad. So the meters are fine, but given input that's the same to two significant figures, the output is off in the first or second significant figure. So when I had it, for example, at 20 volts on the output for the left channel, the right channel read 21 point something volts. Now, that's probably less than the real difference because 20 volts is essentially pegging the meter. You know, at 20 volts, the meter's supposed to read 50 watts, and this is a 50 watt per channel receiver. Although, let me just make sure I've got that right. Continuous power output of 45 watts per channel, so that's interesting. But note that it has you do the adjustment without a load attached. So, with no actual power output. So it tells you that the meters on the front are actually voltmeters, not actual wattage meters. That's fine. That's typical. And in fact, the meters themselves, if you look at the fine print, will say power at 8 ohms. But the issue is that then when I set it at about 10 watts or 8.0 volts on the left channel, but on the right channel it was about 9 volts, I checked the input and the left input was 356 millivolts. The right channel was 358 millivolts. So that's a pretty small difference between inputs and a relatively large difference between outputs. So what could the problem be? I'd say the most likely culprit is the volume control or any of the other potentiometers that the signal has to go through. Those do tend to wear out and or drift a bit. And I don't recall whether I've given these particular pots the deoxit treatment. So I'm going to try that. But in general, you know, I have, for example, potentiometers here on my bench. Here's some salvaged potentiometers that I consider to be good, but I have some over here that I consider to be bad. And the ones that are considered to be bad are where one or both channels is not in spec. You know, on some of these, one of the channels will be in spec, but the other not. You know, this volume knob is two potentiometers. Over time, they will perhaps wear differently and drift differently, if they drift at all. You can't always fix that issue with deoxit or whatever, but sometimes you can. And so we'll give that a shot. I'm not awfully optimistic that it's going to do anything. I think that difference is probably just something I'm going to have to live with unless I change all the potentiometers. And that's a relatively expensive thing to do. I've tilted it up on its side so that I can get into there without tilting the can over too much. And I've got a towel out because this nozzle tends to be messy and drippy. Open, I can point out what I've done with the lights here. There used to be incandescent bulbs in here, just pointing straight up in there. And then this piece of clear plastic serves as the waveguide to bring the light to the front dial. Again, those lights were hot, and over time they variably shrank the vinyl on the wooden cover. So I've both replaced the vinyl with real wood veneer and the old hot incandescent bulbs with LEDs, which should produce much less heat. Now, the way I've done that is I've substituted three LEDs for each bulb in a pretty hillbilly engineered sort of way with this electronic safe adhesive. And it's not perfect, but it's pretty good. To check whether the problem with unbalanced outputs might be related to the volume knob, I can check the resistance over the entire range of the volume knob. You know, there's generally going to be three terminals on a potentiometer, and there's going to be a fixed resistance between the outer two. And what you're doing when you're adjusting the potentiometer is you're adjusting the position of the third between those two extremes. So if the total resistance between the outer two is the same on the two parts, then you ought to get the same volume in each channel. If you don't have the same resistance between those outer two, then you would not expect the volume to be the same on each channel. Jeez, what the hell? It's fluctuating all over the place. It can be problematic checking component values in circuit. You know, essentially what's it doing? It's applying a voltage across the terminals. It's going to apply a voltage and check the current, measure the current, and then calculate the resistance. Something along those lines. It's going to use Ohm's law in any case, whether it puts a constant current across and measures the voltage, or whether it puts the constant voltage across and measures the current. It's going to be using voltage and current to measure resistance. If you've got other components in there, like capacitors that can charge and discharge, if I've got other things in the surrounding circuit that are going to affect the response to putting a voltage on there, then that's a thing. Now, sometimes I've seen some fluctuation even out of circuit, but usually not by this much. So then what I'm going to do is just give each one a final little squirt, and I'll check to see whether anything has changed with regard to the balance between the outputs. Now, in general, it would also be a good idea to treat the various toggle switches. They're just really hard to get anything into. There aren't good openings that are accessible for those. So if there's nothing wrong, then I'm inclined to leave them alone. And same with the push buttons. All right, well, let's check those levels on the output again. Get it on video this time. Set it back to VAC, volts AC, 0 millivolts at zero volume. I'm going to turn it up to 8 volts on the left channel. Get this as close to 8.0 volts as I can, and then see what it is on the other channel. Already I can see that the needle on the meter in the right channel is at a higher value than on the left channel. So I'm going to switch the probes to the right speaker. Here we get 9.2 something volts. So that's a significant difference. And all that deoxit and fiddling the knobs didn't do anything. That's too bad. But there is no other adjustment to be made other than fiddling with the balance right here. I mean, I can turn it towards the left. That will lower the voltage on the right channel and leave the left channel unaffected. So should be able to get that down to 8 volts. So there I can get that to 8.0 volts. Let's see if it's still 8.0 on the other channel. Yeah. So I can get there with the balance. Generally want to use the balance for its intended purpose. That is, when the balance knob is in its default or zero position, you want equal output on the two speakers and then adjust to make them unequal when you want to. Don't want to have to use the balance knob to make the speaker outputs equal. In this case, we do have to. It's not a particularly small adjustment on the balance knob. It had to move it through a significant amount of its range. So let's see exactly how much I had to move it. Put the knob on it, pointed straight up, so that we can see how far I have to move it to get this one down to 8 volts. It's near 10 o'clock. You know, that's a decent amount of its full range. It only goes to, you know, say 7 o'clock at its limit, so I have to use a significant amount of its range to get the outputs equal. Yeah, that's unfortunate. I'd like to change that. I can check some of the different input jacks, like the tape inputs, to see whether there's a difference among those, and that would help to isolate the problem. So let me try that. Put this back up to 12 o'clock. Turn it off. First I'll try tape 1. Okay, this is the tape 1 monitor switch. Okay, so now I'm getting 8.89 volts, which is a little lower than I had before. Let's see what I've got on the other channel. Okay, so they're both attenuated a bit. So if I turn this back up to 8 volts, see if the difference is the same. So recall, when I have this at 8.0 volts with the aux input, the other channel is 9.2 volts. Okay. Yeah, same. So that would tend to exclude the input jacks as the source of the problem and implicate the volume knob or some other component in the signal path. Determined where on the circuit board the pre-amplifier output is to see whether the problem lies in the power amplifier or the pre-amplifier. I'm going to hook in with the oscilloscope probes. That's generally easier to do when I'm looking at actually having to go to a component. Let's see. Hang this on one of the legs of these capacitors. That's the easiest point. And I'm going to hook both of these to chassis ground. I've turned on the source, which is the 1 kHz sine wave. Now I'm going to turn on the amplifier. The volume's probably all the way down. Okay, so channel A reads the magnitude here, 100 millivolts RMS. And of course, then there's the other channel. And these again are the outputs from the preamp section of the circuit. Just looking at it, it looks like the B waveform has a slightly greater amplitude. I can also, of course, check the readings and change those to read channel B. Reading 1. On B, reading 2, on B, okay. So channel B, it's now telling me that's 119 millivolts, roughly 15 millivolts or so higher. That means it's roughly 15% higher, which corresponds to about what the difference is that we're seeing at the output as well. So that does imply that then the discrepancy between the channels that I'm seeing at the output is due to something that's happening in the preamp section and not the power amp section. Again, that could be the volume control, could be one of the switches, could be a number of things, could be resistors that have drifted in value, capacitors that have drifted in value, transistors that have gone wonky, etc. But it's nice at least that I've isolated the problem essentially to the preamp, and the power amp is off the hook in this case. Well, the other thing, of course, is to check the very beginning of the preamp circuit, which is, say, the output from the volume control. Okay, we've got the probes not right on the outputs from the volume knob, but on the other side of a capacitor. I couldn't manage to hook the probes to the volume knob side of that capacitor, but given the value of the capacitor, those shouldn't have any effect, although they could. Here I'm essentially narrowing it down to, is it the volume knob or the capacitor or something downstream of those? Okay, that's 20 millivolts. B is now on the left channel that had the lower amplitude. Change the reading to channel A. And we see 22.7 millivolts, 22.8. Not quite 15% difference. So that does appear to be where the trouble lies, is in that volume control. And that's not too awfully surprising, but does at least tell us if we want to fix the problem, that's where we got to fix it. Needs a new volume control. You know, the deoxit will make it so that it works well through its entire range, but the deoxit isn't going to affect what that range is, what that total resistance is. But anyway, there's our problem. It's that volume knob. Really not much to be done about it at this point, unfortunately.
Hope stained with strange regret, his dreams are dreams.
kitchen sink's full of dishes, so I'm gonna do this in the bathroom. And if you're ever wondering what's safe to use to clean something like this, when in doubt, nothing more than soap and water. As long as I don't scrub roughly, scouringly, it's not going to take off any of the lettering. Knock wood. No guarantees, but pretty good bet that it'll be just fine with soap and water. With a clean face and knobs. I want to see if some of these more persistent stained bits might be attackable with isopropyl alcohol. I need to replace that foam and then I'll be ready to put it back together. It's just, I'm not having any luck with these sort of whitish stains. It's like, you know, you look at it from one angle and it looks okay, and then at a different angle, it's like, I just try a different cleaner. Use some countertop cleaner, see if that'll work. I'm trying this Mrs. Myers, spraying it on there and letting it sit for a bit. Don't know that it's gonna have much of an effect. Hopefully not a negative one. Just have to see. Okay, I think I finally got this looking decent. It's not perfect. So what did I do? Well, I did use some of that Mrs. Myers over and over again, but that really wasn't doing anything. What I finally did was polish it with hard wax, and that mostly has smoothed out the stained bits. It's not perfect, like I said, but, you know, it is still vintage. It's not going to be perfect. We'll be right back.